everybody. Let's get started. We can continue. Hopefully there'll be some rich conversation and activities that will encourage more speaking during the next couple hours, or possibly.
Yeah, I've planned a whole lot of things to say, but if you guys want to get in at any moment, you can tell me how ridiculous it is, how wrong I am, then feel free. I was asked by Alex to do a talk based on my experiences in my previous work doing incubation, and particularly in social innovation entrepreneurship. I got the impression from you that the audience would be younger, maybe students. And he also said small-scale entrepreneurs, social entrepreneurs. And so I built that talk around that. So there's a bit of a caveat to me, but I can see now, I think the audience is more experienced.
But anyway, I'm sure we'll all be interested in how Pete conveys entrepreneurship and shows organizations how to take flight. And I think we're happy at the Sasson Sustainability and Entrepreneurship Center to have Pete here to share his experiences. He's been involved in incubation activities in Myanmar, and he had a few of his own ventures as well. And, you know, we're trying to develop this concept of social entrepreneurship here at Sasson, and we believe that small enterprises are going to be integral to solving global problems in the future. We can't just sit back and count on governments to impose the right kind of regulations to foster this, so hopefully they'll follow along with young entrepreneurs, and we will create a more sustainable future. So let's have Pete give us an interesting talk, and we'll be engaged throughout the day. Thank you.
All right, so yeah, my talk today is quite experimental. There's like this idea that we've played with for a while, and given that I'm building an incubation teaching program for Somerset, maybe in January, you guys are somewhat keen to see if this sort of approach I'm taking is interesting. Your feedback about it is most welcome. But yeah, the purpose of my talk today is firstly to address what Alex has asked me to do, which is basically sharing my perspective about social entrepreneurship. I want to tell you why I think it's a limited concept and what I have wrong with the concept of social entrepreneurship, at least in terms of how it's being taught and how it's being practiced, and what I think we need to do about it, I guess, and as you can tell, it's about taking the concept and trying to see how we can take it to a greater scale. Particularly when Alex was asking me to put this talk together, I unfairly sort of grasped this. What words that he uses, so the audience is likely like a small scale social entrepreneur. Right? I'm not sure if that includes you, but the small scale aspect is something that I think I would like to spend my time in Bangkok addressing. And I think that's something that we scale of social enterprise is something that I really want to unpack and think about how we can do things bigger and better. So that's the first time I'll say. So you probably want to know who I am. I'll just start by saying that I am a social scientist, I guess, or a social researcher, who became a social entrepreneur over time. And I travel, I've been around the world, I've kind of identified more as being a traveler really, but at the moment, I have to give a plug to my new employer, which is Somerset School of Global Studies. We have brilliant bachelor's and master's programs, which you can read about on our website. So that's the information I feel like I should put out from now. But I want to start by talking about my dad. So my dad was a really interesting guy. In his final year of studies at school, he instead of doing his studying for his exams, he built a boat, and he didn't really do very well in his exams. But then when he was in his 20s, he went to night school, which is kind of like what we call a technical college in Australia. And he did his accounting certifications and became an accountant. started doing work, he was really interested in just building a plane. So he built a plane when he was in his 20s, from scratch, out of a kit. And building and flying aeroplanes became his reason for life. It's his lifelong passion. And by the time that he, and he's still alive today, and he's built three or four planes of various sizes and scales. And so I guess this talk is an approach that's kind of dedicated to him, and because I was thinking about business and setting up businesses and trying to communicate, particularly to students, how to set up a business. And it's such a big, messy, esoteric concept that is difficult to visualize what a business is. And so I started thinking about analogies that can help you to understand what businesses are. And I've actually decided that an airplane is a really interesting analogy to tease out. And so, before you think I'm a complete weirdo, there is a purpose to this. But I want you to imagine that you, like my dad, was somehow, for some reason, just possessed by an urge to build an airplane. Right? There was no other priority in your life until you've built this airplane. This is your perfect airplane, the airplane that you would want to build if you had to build an airplane. Okay. So, just for the next 30 seconds, I want you to picture what that airplane looks like. Build a really rich image in your mind about what this airplane that you would want to build if you had to build an airplane looks like. Your dream airplane. Time and money is no limitation, right? But this is something that you have to build. If you want to draw it on a piece of paper, if that's helpful, that's really good. But just work alone. We're not discussing this. It's something that I want you to think about your own dream airplane. Okay? Go for it. 30 seconds. Finish, think more about the environment it's in, the shape that it's in, the way that this airplane came into being. Make that picture as rich as you can, because we're going to be using this. This is the most experimental part of the talk. Okay, finished. Ready? Does anyone have a rich airplane? You don't have to share. It's your own unique airplane. So, I'm going to ask you a bunch of questions about it, right? If you want to write it down, you can. Write your answers down, you can. First, let's talk about the form of the airplane. Is it a unique plane that's never been built before? It's like something that's a creation of your imagination? Or is it a type of plane that you already know, that you already have an idea about? What are its defining characteristics? What makes your airplane unique or different from other types of airplanes? What's its shape? What's its color? What's its texture? How high up is the airplane in your mind, like in the picture? Is it on the ground or is it really high in the air? Let's talk about scale. How big is it? How high is it? How fast is it? Is it moving? Where is your airplane in your mind? Is it flying? Is it on the ground? If it's flying, where is it flying to? What is in the background of your picture? this picture. Are you in the picture? You don't have to be. If so, if you are in the picture, where are you in the picture? Are you in the plane? Are you just looking at it from somewhere? Are you looking at it from first person perspective? Is there anyone else there looking at their plane or involved in the plane? So that's perspective. Let's talk about purpose. What's the plane for? What's it designed for? Does it have a purpose? Does it have a destination? Are you taking the plane somewhere? If so, what will it do when it gets there? Will it deliver some sort of mission? Is it built just for the pleasure of flight? Or is it a business plane to take you to your other important destinations in life? Is it a plane of war where you want to drop missiles from it? Is it a construction of your ego, something that is an artistic expression of who you are, maybe? Mechanics. How does your plane work? How does it move forward? How does it move up? And how does it fulfill the purpose if you have a purpose for your plane? And what about the process? Did you imagine the process of building a plane? Because I said you would be building a plane. Is it a plane that you could realistically build given the amount of time and money that you had in mind? Or is it something that you need help with? What sort of help might you need? So, I'm not sure if you guessed this yet, but I'm using planes as an analogy for business. If we take this analogy of a dream plane as your dream venture, what does this mean about your perspective and what you want to get out of building a business? Assuming you are interested in building a business. What does it say about your desires as an entrepreneur? I'm particularly interested in how big your desires were. What form, what style of plane, and what might that mean for the form and style of venture that you might want to make in the future? What was its purpose? What do you want to do with this plane? So maybe this might say something about you and what you want to do with potentially such a venture as well. And what role do you want to take? If you were the pilot of this plane, maybe it means you should be the CEO. If you're just a passenger on the plane, maybe you're just an investor. I'm not sure. So that's an analogy that I'm interested in playing with. Any questions at this point? Am I completely off the reservation? No? Cool. So I think analogies help in business because, as I mentioned, business concepts can be really esoteric. They're difficult to picture. And being able to visualize something like this can kind of help you to ground your ideas in some sort of understanding of yourself and what you want to do in business. And I think an airplane is also an interesting analogy because it's a big system that can be broken down into subsystems, which actually has some analogies as well, I think, for business. And why I like the aircraft analogy is because there are different styles of business. From the practical to the artistic, there's different styles of airplanes. But they're all still sort of governed by fundamental laws, similar to what governs businesses. And they have to be dealt with. So you can have an airplane as an artistic expression, but it has to get lift, it has to move forward and up fast in some sort of way. And if you're missing one part of the aeroplane, then the whole aeroplane doesn't really work. In the same way, if you're missing one big part of your business and your business model, the whole thing doesn't work. And I think building an aeroplane, same as building a business, requires some thought about design. Thinking about purpose, thinking about the realities that need to be dealt with when you're building a business. And thinking about the priorities that you might have for getting the whole thing up and running and right. So who actually thought about the process of building the plane and how it worked? You did?
I didn't think of it. Yeah, I just thought about the process of building it, but sort of the finished plane was all I could see in my mind.
Right. Well, I think that's... So something that's interesting as well, right? I mean, a lot of entrepreneurs, particularly that came into my incubation program, were really focused about the end vision of what they had without thinking about the steps to get there. So I'm going to take this analogy of a plane. I've already taken it really far. I'm going to take it further. It's the point of ridiculousness, okay? So why is a venture kind of like an airplane? Firstly, the concept of lift, right? You've got air moving over the wing and air moving under the wing. And the difference between the two is what creates lift. And that, I feel like, is kind of like an analogy of a margin. You've got variable costs that a product might have for production. And you've got the revenue that comes in, which is based on price. So margin is kind of like lift. So I think products are kind of like the wings of an airplane. The more wing space is like having more products, and the more opportunities to create lift, which is creating margin and keeping that plane up in the air. I think in that respect, weight is kind of like costs, particularly like fixed costs in a business, but also the variable costs that a wing has, like in terms of lifting up the wing, and then lifting up the rest of the business is the weight is weighing it down, which needs to be offset by margin, which is pulling the wings up and pulling the entire thing up.
Still following me?
And I feel like the fuselage in that respect is kind of like overheads. It's like the management process, the administration process of the business that you set up to hold everything else together, to hold the wings together. And that also has weight that you want to keep lean and streamlined. In this analogy, I feel like speed is like the traction. The more air that's going over the wings is created by the speed. So moving forward and getting traction moves you up, and creates more lift, and starts to make more sustainability in your business model, right? In terms of like keeping it in the air, taking flight. And if that's the case, then the thing that creates the traction, creates the forward momentum, is kind of like marketing, bringing more air over the wings. So I feel like when you're building the market, an engine of an airplane is kind of like the marketing of a business. Hi, welcome. So taking this idea even further, if you think about the process of building a plane and the process of building a business, where are the analogies going? So I feel like designing your airplane is kind of like the ideation. It's like coming up and thinking about what the business model might look like, what the wings look like, what is the engines looking like, and how does it all come together as a system. Building the airplane is kind of like the assembly. So past the ideation, going into the incubation program, is the building of the airplane. And I feel like the runway is like an accelerator, where you're starting to move, you're starting to start those engines, marketing engines, moving the plane forward and trying to start getting traction over the wings to start getting the early stages of lift and then improving on that, adding more acceleration and then hopefully getting airborne at the end of the acceleration process.
Building was thinking?
Incubation.
Building is incubation.
Building an airplane.
And accelerator is?
Well, I think the runway is like an accelerator. And eventually you come to the end of the runway where the ground stops supporting you and you either you take off or you crash, right? And getting airborne is kind of like getting profitable. You want to get profitable by the end of the runway, otherwise, especially if you're on an aircraft carrier, you're going to get to the ocean. And then like once you're flying is like performance. You're either having more lift than your weight and going up, or you've got more costs than your profit and going down. It's kind of like your height is kind of like the money you make. So that's about as far as the analogy I'm going to take it right now. But this is the picture I wanted to sort of like paint in your mind.
You left landing.
Landing. Well, there are limitations to the analogy. I think the biggest difference with the biggest limitation to this analogy is that actually an aircraft a business, a venture, you continue building while you're on the runway, taking flight. While you're in the air, you continue to build, and that obviously doesn't happen for an airplane. But and yeah, but at the same time, an airplane, you might want to land somewhere. Like maybe there's a destination you want to go.
I think landing is like reporting, annual reporting.
Annual reporting.
You got to come back to the ground. You got to assess where you are.
Well, in my interpretation of the analogy, it's like your height is the amount of money you're making. And if you start losing lift, it's like your bank account's going down, 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 you're going down. So I'm not sure if there's supposed to be a runway there somewhere, but maybe that's your exit. I don't know. Let's see.
You sold the company to the venture capitalist and you run off.
So, I'm going to sort of apply this concept to the social enterprises that I built. Okay. So, my first ever business was actually the first business incubator in Vienna, which was very much a social enterprise. It was a pretty classic incubator. We coached a lot of social innovators and entrepreneurs about how to build businesses with a bunch of services that we provided. We gave space, we gave connected them to mentors, we gave one-on-one coaching, networking events, investor pitches, put it all together in a donor-funded incubation program. But it was a business. We made money out of it, and we actually did okay. So I feel like my first business was like this. Right. Where it was ugly, it was put together relatively roughly, but it was okay. We delivered a service with our aircraft. For the person who came in late, there's a whole weird process that you mostly missed, so I'm not sure if you can catch up at this point, but if you're having trouble. But so yeah, it was small, ugly, but practical. It had a purpose, and it was designed to deliver that specific social purpose. Delivering a sort of relief in some way. It wasn't designed to fly fast or high, to perform particularly well. It just wanted to deliver the impact we wanted to have. So we ran that for about 4 years, and then a competitor came along and just basically did everything at a bigger scale. And so we didn't feel like we had to do that business anymore. We were sort of happy. At the same time I was building the first business, I built my second business, which was essentially a consulting company, a development consulting company, where we did research and advisory for international NGOs, multilateral companies. Very classic, nothing particularly innovative, we're just sort of selling our time to do advisory projects, which just a whole lot of time. Gradually we hired more people and tried to reach more scale, which meant that we took on less fun projects. And then multinational companies came along and just like scouted all our people, and we couldn't hold on to our good people. And in the end, it was just like, we overcommitted, we signed so many contracts and all that stuff with multinational companies in Myanmar. And it all just came onto me. And so my second business felt like that. It was just like a lot of work. It's either I just pedaled like mad and worked really hard, or I just sort of crashed to the ground. But look, it was lean, it was uncomplicated, it wasn't hard or expensive to build. A consulting company is the easiest of a company just to set up. But gosh, it was a lot of work. So I'm not even sure how that relates to the analogy, but it's just like a whole lot of hard work. So it's been a while since I left Myanmar, like a few years now. And since it's been a while since I was advising startups, so I've had two other businesses that I've been trying to set up in the meantime, which gave me a whole lot of time to think about scale and how to set up a business and how I was doing it wrong when I was in Myanmar in terms of the way I advise social enterprises and other businesses. So the first business I've made since I left Myanmar was a travel tech startup. And after setting up these two previous businesses, which went okay, but in the end, I kind of got a bit bored and uninspired by them. It was part of an industry which I thought was really grueling. Like the international development industry is so screwed up in so many ways. So the next business I made, I really wanted to make it the dream business for me. Kind of like the dream aeroplane. And it kind of, in my mind, looked like this. It was compact, fast, maneuverable, agile. It was sleek and stylish. But it was just a whole lot of fun to fly. And that was the only purpose. I just wanted to have a business where I really enjoyed being part of the business, have fun going to work every day. There's only enough room for me and a co-founder. I didn't want to have a huge amount of people to deal with because that was awful when I was running a consulting company. There's no mission other than just to enjoy myself, really. It was a travel tech company called Windows here. Good morning. And I love travel, so it was related to that, and I love writing, there's a lot of writing involved, but in the end, even though I went through the whole sort of design process that I've been advising startups in Myanmar and other places to go through, I read all and practiced all the thought leadership in terms of the wisdom of Brad Feld and Eric Ries and doing lean startups and the process of doing business. And I really enjoyed sort of like taking my own path in business that I sort of found through my experiences and trying to apply my wisdom about businesses that I've developed in developing a product. We built an excellent product, I thought, my co-founder and I. And we got in front of real customers and reiterated the product, the prototype, the alpha, the beta, etc. But in the end, it failed because there was an elephant in the room, and it basically, the marketing was an afterthought. I just assumed that this product would have a huge customer base, and it had a really unique marketing problem where we had to get people's attention at the right time in terms of their travel journey. And I just assumed that there'd be an easy answer to it. Kind of like this, it's like you've got an engine at the back, which is kind of weak, and it's kind of the afterthought. And so, in the end, it hasn't taken off. I'm still actually working on it taking a completely different redesigning approach to it to try to put the engine at the center of it. We're still working on it. And the other business that I've built since Myanmar, or I was in the process of building since Myanmar, was actually someone else's startup. A couple of guys based in Singapore, and they engaged me for 6 months to try to get this startup built. It's a really simple product, which provided information about how to climb mountains in Southeast Asia. And so it's a web-based thing. Nothing particularly innovative, nothing groundbreaking, nothing new. And unlike Windows Eater, where I was dealing with the growth problem at the end, we dealt with the growth problem at the very beginning. And I started designing this marketing machine at the very beginning of the product. But eventually, when I came to the end of my contract, which is in September, we had a growth model, right? But it wasn't really sufficiently fast and powerful, a growth model, to keep the co-founders and owners of the business really engaged. And since September, it's essentially hasn't had anything done because I feel like they've failed to be enthusiastic about it. So it's kind of like this. It was a really rough little airplane. It did have the engine as like the centerpiece. It had simple little wings, simple little organization to encapsulate the pilots, but in the end,
it's a Spitfire.
That's not a Spitfire. That's the plane my father built when he came to the when he was studying in the academy. And it flew for about 30 years, so it's a good plane, but the reason why I'm using this plane as an analogy, it's like, it's not a powerful plane, and the engine is not going to send it into the stratosphere, and that's what my co-founders that I work with, Summit.com, that's what they really wanted. So, in the end, the design, it works, and it was a good plane, I was quite proud of it, but it wasn't sufficient. So what's the point? What am I getting to? I feel like these experiences taught me a lot about the challenges of reaching scale in particular, and having an impact at scale. Right? They're all in some ways, I mean, this one wasn't particularly but I always had a social intent when I came to businesses. And so it convinced, these experiences convinced me that I've been advising startups all along. And so this lecture is my return to the world of advising startups, which I'm about to be doing next year when I go to an accelerator for Texas University. And I'm going to deliver something completely new, right? And I'm going to get things right. And so,
when you talk about scale, can you, well, not necessarily quantify it, but there must be various levels of scale and defined by those creating the venture, right? I mean, scale for some people could be to be a billionaire, and for others just to survive, right? So what, how does scale define, and you know, does it have different meanings? Or?
Good point. I think from a commercial perspective and from a socialist perspective, you can define the scale differently. And I personally feel it's like a return on the investment. It's the best way to define it. And from a commercial perspective, scale can be easily defined because the return on investment is a very known entity in terms of as a capital. Right, so let's assume that return on investment is one axis, and then we'll make social return on investment a different axis. And this is a very problematic concept, as I'm sure you know. Right? But my perspective is that if you're trying to have an impact, the world has such big problems at this point that having an impact at small scale is not sufficient anymore. I think that if you're a social entrepreneur and have a small return on investment, social impact, then you're no longer relevant. Problems are now too big. So how we define small scale versus big scale is social problems. It's a very difficult axis to be trying to quantify, I guess. But you know, I think we know where we sit. When we think about small scale social enterprise, which is maybe you know, a restaurant that's set up to help employ disadvantaged people. There's like three of these in the MRI. That's great. It's commercially viable, right? So it's a positive. But in terms of social scale, there's maybe like 5 people employed there in one time. Maybe they have 100% rotation per year, so we're talking about 5 people being offered jobs per year. Is that scale? Whereas, can we think about a social venture at scale? Maybe the biggest scale social ventures I see are in the engineering sector, where they're getting grant money and just delivering immunization at scale, they're delivering food at scale, delivering something very practical against a very practical problem, but hitting numbers. And I think like the hitting of the numbers things is what makes it a scale of social action. I think PSI is probably great with this because they're really about numbers and trying to get return on investment in terms of their social impact investment. Right? So, PSI. It's an NGO that I at least that works in Myanmar. They deliver condoms and nutritional supplements, but they're basically building a delivery mechanism that is oriented only towards scale. And like, for every dollar that goes in, they're measuring the amount of condoms and the amount of nutrition outcomes that are being delivered, and then and trying to improve that. Trying to work towards this sort of direction as much as possible. And then the more investment that goes into the system, the more scale as an overall net, overall sum amount that is created. So in my perspective, there is sort of like what we call a production possibility frontier. Anyone in economics background would know about this, but basically there are big NGOs down here, right? Making a huge amount of scale, but not making any sort of financial return. If anything, like, they can't exist, no venture can exist under this line independently, right? Because they have to pay their commission bills, they have to pay their salaries. So they get lifted up here by by donors, basically. And then you got private sector here that is making huge returns on investment. I mean, there's plenty of private sector, even NGOs down here as well, where they're not making a positive impact, they're not making a financial impact, and eventually they're just dying, right? And then this is what we call the social enterprise space, where we're trying to do both things. But can anyone name something which is up here in the social enterprise space?
I could in my conceptual design.
In your conceptual design?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well, I do conceptual design. I'm an engineer. I've got a flood prevention system.
Flood prevention system?
Yeah, which if it was incorporated, it has to be done in a total country or a river catchment area.
Right.
So you go into all the little branches of the tree, tributaries, and the leaves you turn into reservoirs. So you distribute and you completely develop the country. And you make a lot of money apart from investing in jobs and infrastructure and return and preventing flooding. You also create generic electricity and second and third cropping.
Cool. Where are you at with it?
I'm here. I'm at nowhere. I've been here for 8 years. It's been at Chula. It was going to be brought into their syllabus by Chadwick, Professor Chadwick, but he didn't finance it. It's been
why isn't it a venture that's like already operating and sustainably making money?
Because I can't, we can't do things the way we've been doing in the past, but people keep doing things that has been done in the past. Mm-hmm. This is a new way, it needs huge political and financial commitment, and no one's prepared to do it at this time. Mm-hmm. Although I'm going to Sri Lanka next year, maybe I've got a government connection.
Okay.
I've been to Nepal, I've been to Bhutan.
Sure.
All interested, but politically.
But it's not a sustainable venture that is
taking
flight.
Not yet. No, it's ready to go.
Does anyone have an example of a sustainable venture which is in this territory?
What about something like one of the educational apps or something like that?
Like Khan Academy, for example?
Yeah.
I think that's the best example I can think of.
Khan Academy is for profit, isn't it? I'm pretty sure it is.
Yeah.
But, well, whether it's that or... I don't know whether you would say that Coursera has a social return on investment or one of those, but...
Yeah.
I mean, they do...
But
they do give a social...
I feel like...
In that they're giving educational outcomes, but...
I feel like the organisations that are using technology now to expand the sort of space of this, in terms of business models that you can do...
Yeah.
Are starting to do things at greater scale. And particularly the engines that are driving people towards it and delivering their impact are better because they're so much more scalable, particularly in technical sort of thing.
I don't know how well it's doing presently, but the Grameen Bank model, micro enterprise banking, that was I think an idea that was really scalable and was expanding, but there's
I feel like they're probably in this sort of territory.
Okay.
I don't think they make a huge amount of profit, but they definitely did expand because they're also, they get a lot of donations, right? Or are they completely funded by their customers?
Well, it's basically small scale loans, right?
Yeah.
So they're supported, they pay back their loans. They found that their rate of returning and paying back loans was probably higher than larger scale businesses.
Okay. I think there's a lot of, in terms of microfinance, that business model in general, particularly people that followed Grameen in the mobile and finance areas of Bangladesh, they sort of like took a pivot towards this direction, but you could probably say that they're still pretty good.
I'm sorry, Peter. This is very business or industry specific.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, this is very... Yeah, okay, you're right.
So I mean, if you talk about grammar things, the frontier things is the kind of economics things that you cannot break it, right? You cannot go over here. If you look at the grammar thing within the financial industry, you're still along that line. Right? I mean, you talk
along
about
this line.
Yeah, along this line. So if they are not really outside, you see what I mean? I mean, if you look at a lot of different businesses, they have different lines. So I mean, my thinking is within certain industry, I don't think there's any way to break outside the frontier.
Netflix, social impact.
Well, actually, I think the best example, because I thought a lot about this and trying to think of examples out here, I reckon think somewhere in this space you could probably say telcos.
Wait, no. Telecommunications companies.
Oh, okay. Is it making outrageous returns on investment? It's like about 50% of all times.
Not all. I used to work at them.
Good.
I think the biggest profit margin anyone can get is property.
I was talking to the head of CSR in Myanmar from Telenor, Sam Peoples Detail, and he said they get 45% ROI.
And I mean, they've made a ridiculously large investment, so the total investment was like $1 billion investment. But now, in terms of their operational returns, it's incredible. And you can make an argument that there has been social benefit created, but there's also been social costs.
So, have you heard of M-Pesa in Kenya? Yeah, like that's making outrageous amounts of money. It has been for a long time.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, mobile money, mobile telephony, mobile finance, I feel like, and mobile education. Some of these things I think are maybe starting to record this area. But overall, social enterprise, I feel like is always here. And they're not really making huge social returns on investment is the broad, difficult concept that I'm trying to struggle with. Just, I think that answers your question. I can't wait for questions anymore.
Sure, I can remember what my original question was.
Scale.
So
what is scale?
Thank you very much. Right. So I think it depends on, you know, what, I guess the question is, you know, some kinds of ventures are not that concerned about ROI. I mean, breaking even and creating a high social impact, is what a social enterprise should be about. Not as long as you're breaking even, you're paying salaries and people that are involved in
this line somewhere.
Right. But I would say that's a success in scale. That's, I guess, would be my argument.
If you're not making profit, you're just a not-for-profit.
No.
Yeah. This conceptually difficult because an NGO can scale, right? And how does an NGO scale? They deliver a project well, and they get another donor of a bigger scale, and it's kind of like they have return on investment somehow too, but they just reinvest their profits into scaling up their impact, right? Which is kind of what a lot of social enterprises do. In the same way that, like Amazon, the tech company, they for the first 14 years of their existence, they didn't return a single dividend to their investors. They just kept everything in the business to scale up the business, and essentially it was operating like a non-profit. It was only like 2 years ago, I think, that they started actually declaring a profit. Everything otherwise.
That was like Starbucks, wasn't it? Until people started complaining.
Right?
Starbucks, they weren't making a profit either, were they, for 12 years?
Yeah, so.
And they're a fiddling factor.
So yeah, I mean, companies can be operating here, and so it's not a completely perfect sort of axis that you can, but it helps me to understand what I think scale is. But basically, if you're making a large return on investment, there is lift, right? There is money that is being created by your business activities that you can reinvest into making your business activities bigger, if you want. Otherwise, you can pay out the investors. In the same respect here, but more difficult things, like if you're making a huge amount of impact, you go and knock on the doors of donors, and you ask them, all say, I'm making a huge, for every dollar you give me, I can immunize 10,000 children. The other guy's going to immunize 5,000. Then that's something that you can start to reach more scale with. But this is where I think about at least the act of achieving scale. In terms of actually being at scale, like I'm not sure where I would draw the line. It really depends on the engineer. But the reason why I think I've been teaching, at least in Myanmar, social enterprises wrong is because, particularly like the design thinking approach, the human-centered design approach, it's all product-focused. It's all focused on building the wings of the plane, right? It's like you're building a glider. Like, every entrepreneur that ever came to my program would only start building the engine, building the marketing machine at the very end when they think, oh, we've got a product now, I better go sell some products, right? And I think that's just the wrong way to do business. It's so human-centered design and design thinking, fantastic way to build a product. Terrible way to build a business, because because all the other parts of building the system around the plane, particularly the thing that makes it go forward and move faster and make scale, is an afterthought. I'm of the perspective that an innovative idea that's not reaching scale is essentially not valuable, and we shouldn't be helping entrepreneurs to build things that can't be scaled, right? I also feel like the vast majority of social enterprises are kind of incomplete businesses in this respect. When they eventually do get around to creating a machine from moving forward to reaching scale, it's something that's like half-assed and put together very quickly without a huge amount of thought, you know? So, I'm gliders here. So like gliders. It's all wing and there's not much substance. Sometimes, you know, you can build a glider that is just purely there to get support from someone who does have mechanisms of creating money. That's essentially an NGO. They often pivot towards having an NGO model because they aren't able to scale it themselves. There are some social enterprises that build an engine as kind of like an afterthought that just like straps on, and that's okay. But generally, I feel like what really needs to be done is putting the engine at the center of the plane and building the plane around the engine, building the wings as part of this integrated system that is engine first. And I feel like this is the private sector mindset that has to come into social enterprises as well, making sales the center of your business, making sales, the act of going out, building a marketing funnel, that should be the beginning of any social enterprise rather than thinking about the product. And really, the stronger, the better the marketing funnel, the better the social enterprise. This is actually the plan that I've built a second, and I guess you're interested. Obviously, it's not just marketing funnel, that's really good, but you know, what if you can have two big, strong marketing funnels that really drive a business? Then you can build an awesome plane that can do all sorts of achievable impact with it, right?
Just an add-on.
Yes.
Thinking about, in terms of your metaphor, we didn't really talk about the fuel, the energy that drives the plane, which
That's also something that doesn't fit into my metaphor very well. So.
It doesn't fit in? I think it does, because in my opinion, the fuel would be the capital, the financial capital needed to make the plane go up.
Right, but where do you get the fuel once the plane's up there? Anyway, I've got an answer to that, but I feel like it would be too much to stretch for that. I feel like, firstly, we should be starting with the engine, starting with the marketing machine, starting with the growth funnels, as the first thought process that we can put people through in any incubation acceleration program. And I feel like the vast majority of social enterprises don't do this. They're product focused. They're trying to build a business around the product. I think that's partly why we're not seeing scalable social enterprises. The other thing is innovation is overrated. I feel like there are so many business models that can create an impact without having to be particularly innovative, either in their products or in the way that they operate. You know, you could build an incredibly new, weird business that's never been done before. But there are business models out there that products that can just be applied to a new market segment, applied to a new underprivileged segment to deliver value. And that, as an idea, should be preferred instead of trying to create an entirely new product or something that's an entirely new way of doing business, which is something that we incubators and accelerators tend to do too much. So I think if it's a purely commercial incubation or acceleration program, then I feel like there is some merit in trying to design something that's entirely new and never been done before. But that's generally, I think, it's at the technology frontiers when you're trying to apply new technology to a new type of business to create new new financial returns. So yeah. I feel like we should instead be just applying known, proven concepts of creating lift and creating trust to solving social problems at scale, you know, where there's a whole lot of gaps. Having said that, I feel like technology is underrated, right? I feel like innovative ideas that are turned into products that help, that people are willing to pay good money for, and which have a lean business model, and a proven growth model, and a great team, and an execution mindset, and add some time and money to play with, then this is a really interesting business model that we should be entertaining. I think you guys enjoy it. And so this is an example I came up with. Like, there's just like new technologies there that allow us to do things in new ways. And so operating in a technology frontier is something that most social incubators and social accelerators aren't doing that well, in terms of just like bringing people into the frontiers of technology.
Anyone have a 5-minute break?
Sure, if you want.
People like a quick restroom break,
20 minutes,
coffee, tea, or dinner.
Coffee break. Any questions at the point? Am I off topic? Am I completely off the reservation in terms of my analogy thing? Do you think it's helpful?
Can you be my salesman for my design?
I think it's very good. I'd like to hear what everyone have thought of as their airplane.
Oh, yeah?
And how they have done it in the past or doing now.
Well, maybe we can ask people over the coffee break.
Yeah.
You want to take 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Good. Got a question, Michael?
I was going to ask what... you've talked about social enterprise, social return on investment, but what do you see as, can you define, delve down deeper into what you mean by a social business? What?
To be honest, I feel like every business in the world is on that spectrum, right? And I think most businesses are trying to do both. In some way or form, it just comes down to the mix that in terms of their efforts. So if you are a business operating here, which there are a lot of businesses doing, I feel like there are a lot of businesses trying to move in that direction, have less of it.
But how do you define what you call the sort of the social problem or the social issue that you're trying to address?
How do you identify the social problem that you're trying to
address? Like what can you talk about, can you just like what are you talking about? Are you talking about trying to help the disadvantaged, like disabled groups like that, or are you trying to, solve poverty problems, or?
Okay, let's stick with poverty problems, right?
Yeah.
Last week I was in Myanmar doing a research project to try to build business models around a particular type of fish, making that fish. The fishing of that more sustainable and making it creating more livelihoods for poor people.
Right.
So that's really easy to put on this spectrum. It's like we're assessing what types of models of fishing practices yields most income in terms of people's incomes. And if they're poor people, then like you can talk about the number of poor people that have more money in their pockets than the amount of income you bring to people. Defining poor people is going to be problematic, of course.
Yeah.
Right? And then you've got another impact metric there, which is nutrition. So the more people fishing means more fish in their diet, proteins, instead of just rice. So even that very basic thing in terms of doing intervention with fishing, actually is about a very specific type of fish in Myanmar. Supporting got two social impact types that we could be putting on that axis, which are completely different. And if you were to have two different business models, one which creates more income and one less nutrition, and one that makes more nutrition and less income, how do you compare the two? Already that's, it's a different thing. Actually, even from a biological point of view, making more sustainable fishing practices is a social good for the environment, making sure that there is more fish and biodiversity in the ocean, the ecosystem is more healthy. That's another type of social impact which is completely incomparable with creating livelihoods and nutrition for human beings in a difficult situation. So you could list a million different types of social impact, and trying to compare one type to another is something that makes this axis so much less known than this axis.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
To the point that, you know, there are so many NGOs that are claiming this and achieving that, and then growing their impact models based on some convoluted impact metric,
you know,
process that it's almost a completely irrelevant concept. But we do know that certain things create social impacts and certain things don't, right? So it does exist, it's just that I just don't. I have trouble, you know, having that conversation with anyone who's claiming to make more impact than this guy, because different types of impact are different kinds of things. You know, it depends on the values of an individual about whether making environmental impact or social impact is more important.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I'm answering your question, but that's kind of a little rant for you.
No, but it's a good discussion.
Did you take a photo?
Because it's just saying, like, just for a little bit.
Most social enterprises that I see just perform weakly in terms of both
social return on investment and financial return on investment. And I feel like there needs to be a change in mindset of social enterprise towards growth, an obsession about growth. And this basically means that you should be spending the vast majority of your time building the engine rather than the wings, building the marketing funnel out, experimenting with that, making it more efficient, rather than just trying to develop new funds and new products that could create a potential social impact. I feel like there are already so many existing products and business models that could be applied to social sector problems. And so innovating entirely new products and entirely new ways of doing business is not necessarily to where social enterprises should be focused, particularly in markets like Thailand. I also feel like technologies that are coming out are creating new potential business models, which are potentially offering far greater scale. And we're talking about some of the new business models that are coming out of the internet age, out of the mobile money age, and these are some of the more impactful social enterprises that we can listen to. And so an engagement with technology in a fundamental level, I feel like should be part of every incubator and so on. One other point in terms of mindset, I feel like there should be, especially in Thailand, a far greater engagement with the corporate sector. Because in Thailand, the corporate sector has all the wealth. It's one of the most unequal, inequitable societies in the world. And big business own all the assets. They have all the platforms which can reach scale. And particularly the new technology platforms seem to be captured by big business in Thailand more so than any other country that I've been to, where new startups are building new platforms that can help distribute all sorts of products and services, some of which could be social. So I feel like we have to engage with the big guys, and particularly in Thailand. Right? So those are some of my perspectives about social enterprise and where I see there being weak, and where I feel like they can make a difference. So what do we do about it? Okay. Firstly, I feel like we need to ditch the idea of social enterprise as being such a distinct form of business from other business models, that being the private sector. I feel like private sector, particularly the big guys, are in such an opportunity, such a position that they can create huge social impact at scale, that we should be engaging them more to use their platforms to create social impact. That's maybe not a small scale social enterprise incubation acceleration problem, but I feel like social enterprise should encompass, incorporate the corporate sector much more rather than being offended and balking at the idea of big business. So I feel like at least in most countries that I've been operating, social entrepreneurs don't want anything to do with big corporations, which I think is a misogyny. The social sector is not significantly different from the private sector. Everyone's trying to make more money, everyone's trying to make more impact. Well, not everyone, but most people. Most of your social enterprise heroes are not doing that well. They're not really reaching scale. Sure, you can think of, you know, the Grameen Bank and Muhammad Yunus, but can you think of more than one or two social entrepreneurs who are your heroes? But really, your business heroes are probably going to be Elon Musk and your Bill Gates, that's right. I was trying to think about, I've been asking people, who are the heroes of social enterprise in Thailand? Can you think of anyone in Thailand that have really reached scale and is expanding overseas and is delivering impact at scale? Someone came up with an example, but it's kind of like it was a marketing service to help other businesses create.
Red Bull's fairly international.
Red Bull? Are they a social enterprise?
Energy, man, they give energy.
defining social impact is...
Jasper. Jasper.
James Perry.
Jasper.
It's a rice.
I think it buys rice. Yeah,
Siam Organic.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's actually assassin on that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Big hero. Cool. But generally, I feel like nobody's reaching good enough scale that, you know, we should feel comfortable. I feel like the problems are still too big, and the heroes of social enterprises are still operating at a smaller scale. But
we have to really think hard about social enterprises concept and thinking about whether it's delivering the sort of impact that we need it to. My second suggestion is that we, I think I already mentioned this, stop thinking about products. Think first and almost exclusively about marketing, right? This whole build it and they will come sort of mentality is being scrutinized by everyone, but like this whole Silicon Valley prototypical story of coming up with this incredible new idea and then like creating product on all sides, it was a huge overnight sensation, took off and they reached a scale and they got investments from their garage into like a big office and then now billionaires. That doesn't really apply, particularly in the social sector, and increasingly outside of Silicon Valley, that's really lonely because Silicon Valley is all about software as a service, right? And those businesses are hugely scalable by default, and leading the technology frontier and finding new business models that are being demanded a lot more than most of the social enterprise spaces that we've got social entrepreneurs addressing. I feel like social entrepreneurs, particularly coming through incubators like Assassin or Temasat or anywhere, should be following the avant-garde of marketing, digital marketing, growth marketing, getting into marketing communities of practice, like whether it's Reddit groups or meetups, Coursera and Udemy have like these little communities around marketing. They should be playing with platforms of marketing, whether it's the Grab or whatever, like what are the new platforms of marketing and how we can use them to work commercially. They should be playing with marketing campaigns as, in terms of the messaging, their choices of channels and the way that they do their marketing. That should be a core to what we have in our acceleration incubation programs. And I feel like you can experiment with marketing techniques for a long time before you have to actually apply product to it. You can build an engine for a long time, obsessed building a great marketing engine before you have to strap wings on it and start to monetize it. And particularly, they should be doing this in accelerators. You can build an email list around an idea, an interest, a problem that you guys have in the community. You can build a brand identity and start promoting that brand before having necessarily even a problem that you want to address with a product. You can go out and you can meet 200 people with the same problem and start getting their details, feed them into some sort of marketing funnel before you even start thinking about how you're going to solve their problem, a particular product. And this actually ties in nicely with design thinking, like just empathizing with your students, with your potential customers. And you can build an entire movement and then give it a platform and then start to think about the products you can offer to this movement to someone. I feel like this is the approach that we should be promoting for social enterprise. I also feel like in terms of the mindset, social entrepreneurs that I've met and have worked with aren't thinking at scale. If you ask them what would they do with $100,000, right? Most social entrepreneurs won't have an answer. But really, you should be asking them, what would you do with $10 million or $1 billion? How would you deal with that sort of money? Have you got a plan for that? What would you do if you had to achieve that plan in 6 months instead of 5 years, which is what time horizons most social entrepreneurs are thinking in? How would you handle that growth if it came in thick and fast? Generally, you'd have to sort of like put aside the idea of carefully planning your business model, making cautious investments, and solving all the problems that come up to your business, one by one and thoroughly and properly. And instead, you have to start making rough estimates, take whatever investment you can take, and just like letting small fires burn, in terms of problems that come up in your business. And it's a different sort of mentality, just prioritizing speed over efficiency in the face of all the uncertainty. So thinking, upscaling thinking is another thing that we should encourage in incubation programs and acceleration programs. On the topic of technology, people should be updating their thinking, particularly updating the people that they're hanging out with, right? The communities of practice.
students going through social incubation programs, acceleration programs, social entrepreneurs even, should be engaging thoroughly with science and technology. Because we now have the largest population ever. We're all hyper-connected. We have opportunities to exchange ideas faster than ever. And this history tells us is when cultural evolution occurs, when things happen at scale quickly. All the great modernizations in the past happened when there was more hyperconnectivity. So this should be happening. And social entrepreneurs should be putting themselves into the possibility space of meeting new people with new technologies and new ideas so that they can start applying them to their business models, to start building partnerships to reach scale. I think social entrepreneurs also aren't good prioritizers. Thinking about the plane, what is your ultimate purpose of the plane? What does it mean to do? So what can be cut off the plane? What part of your plane is actually just ego? It's theatrics, or it's some sort of fantasy. You know, if you have a purpose in your plane, keep that purpose the only purpose. Prioritize that only there. And then take away every other part of your plane that you can that isn't achieving that purpose. And this can be applied to social enterprise business models by stripping away all the ego, all the theatrics of social enterprise, all the fantasy social enterprise, and being single-mindedly determined and building a business to only deliver impact at scale. And then prioritizing, like the immediate priority of all new social ventures is just to be airborne, to get to the point that they're profitable, they can keep paying their salaries, they can keep paying their rent, they can keep paying their air conditioning bill. And then they should be comfortable with putting off other things such as some of the social impact return choices until later date. And so the last thing I'm going to say is I think that scale will only happen when all the following come into play. Firstly, a good value proposition, which basically means a solution that people are willing to pay good money for. Margin, which in our analogy is lift, so basically your costs are lower than your price, so charging a high price and keeping costs low. A growth model, the engines. Basically a way of getting people down your marketing funnel, a way of getting more and more velocity to get more air over your wings and creating more lift. A good team that has been proven to have the capabilities it needs, proven to operate together, particularly under sort of incubation and acceleration processes, you should be building teams. And that doesn't happen necessarily when you're doing a human-centered design thinking process. And then the mindset, creating an execution mindset which is commercially oriented, commercially respectful, realizing that they need to make money and that's a critical component to reaching scale. Having a scale orientation, desperately trying to increase the speed and the efficiency of that marketing engine, going out, putting themselves in front of customers and making sales, and then having the ability to really hyper-prioritize and only do the things that are pushing them towards more impact and more scale. And then finally, they just need time, basically. An incubation program is great for that, an acceleration program is great for that. And capital is great for that because it buys you more time than you pay salaries and pay commission. So those six things: value proposition, margin, growth model, team, mindset, and time. Those are what accelerators and incubators should bring. That's all I have for today. So we ended with.
What about the first suggestion about all right. Making airplanes?
So we had a suggestion that people should share their ideas about their airplanes. Does anyone want to share? And we can maybe sort of like dissect that about what you want to do with your business, if that's the case.
Maybe why don't we just exchange discussions about what we talked about, we learned about the idea, because I think everyone has different experiences in life, in enterprise, in social enterprise.
I have a question. So your suggestion that we move away from just thinking about the product and use marketing, right? Can you give an example of a social enterprise that you think is really effective with the use of marketing? Because for example, Doi Doi, my founder foundation, they have this set up, Doi Doi as a social enterprise to get the
to coffee, to other things, frog breaks, right? And now we have going on, and it's a pretty cool sort of enterprise, and like, and I think like Duke wanted to scale it up, you know, and he came to Central Group and he was like, you know, what can we do together for Central Group to scale this up? Because, you know, Central Group is like this huge retail conglomerate and we have the distribution networks and everything. And I think like when I was at Central Group in the past year, they were trying to have their own social enterprise with Good Goods. It's like a shop that just opened on Central World, like, you guys can check it out. I find it very boring because it doesn't have a, like an environmental aspect to it yet. It's only like, oh, we're helping poor people, you know. But I think like the potential is something like Doigong, but not necessarily just Doigong, but to get all the brands in Thailand to have the huge networks of something like Central Group. Mm-hmm. And I thought that marketing was the way too, you know. Mm-hmm. So, but what is it that needs to be unlocked that you're suggesting? And like, do you have a ceiling for the definition of social enterprise? Because like you asked us, like, what do you think is a really good social enterprise who's really successful, a social entrepreneur? I think Tom's Shoes is quite successful. They have shoes and glasses. Tom's Shoes, you buy one, you donate one to kids in poor countries. And it, like, do you have like a ceiling of like the definition of social enterprise? Like, if they make too much money, if it's Jessica Alba, you know, the celebrity, you know, she had kids and then she couldn't find anything like safe enough for her kids. They were allergic to everything that was labeled like, you know, safe. And so she came up with the Honest brand. And she sells everything from Pampers to lotions, and it's all like, you know, very eco-friendly, very human-friendly. I think that's a social enterprise. I think she's a successful social entrepreneur. But do you not consider that social enterprise because it's like big branding, big marketing, it's commercial, it's not really impactful, they're not doing SROI, you know, so what do you have an example of like how you can utilize marketing to make it a successful social enterprise?
Okay, so I think there are two questions there, right? Firstly, about marketing and examples of someone who does marketing well in social enterprise. And the second one is about the definition of social enterprise and where I would draw the boundaries. The second one first, I don't use the word social enterprise. I think it's problematic. And I don't know. I guess using the term can be helpful for people who are going for funding. But the identity of social enterprise, I feel like someone who calls themselves a social entrepreneur, I feel like it's more likely to be anti-private sector and therefore anti all of the things I think is, you know, cool. I mean, and creating problems because they don't lean on the private sector and set private sector practices, private sector cultures, private sector marketing practices in particular, in their business models. And they want to be separate from that, they don't want to identify with that. And so, having said that, social enterprise is a phrase that people like, you know, Ashoka and Echoing Green and Acumen Funds attach to the funding. So maybe if you want to be a social entrepreneur, you have to employ some social entrepreneur. Otherwise, you're not really open to that sort of like community of practice and community of funding. And so, having said that, I feel like the social enterprise concept, it's been around for at least like 15 years or something. And we're still not seeing a huge amount of scaled social enterprises that are calling themselves social entrepreneurs. We're seeing a whole lot of scaled businesses that would call themselves just entrepreneurs or even corporate sector people that are creating impact at scale and making a value judgment about them versus a social entrepreneur. I think it's really just it's confusing. It's not really relevant.
So give us an example then of a company that you think has a great social impact versus the negative impacts. Because what I see is, you know, from my experience, kind of on the inside and the outside, you know, a company, for example, like Patagonia, now they look fantastic on paper, on their website, but really, you know, if you looked into the processes, all the products they sold, how many of those products are made from recycled materials? They're claiming this and that, and then, you know, what is the impact of running that corporation? Electricity, water usage in their facilities, I mean, the list goes on. And how many, you know, I mean, it's complicated. You know, I agree with you on one side about the social entrepreneur, but again, companies, you know, when you talk about social impact, like, you know, maybe like Bill and Gates, I mean, like
Bill Gates, what is it called? The fund that provides innovation,
Gates Foundation,
yeah. Right? So the Gates Foundation. So there are companies, but then they have philanthropic entities which create a social impact, and then those are, you can debate the impact of those, but an organization that's, you know, intertwines the, both those aspects, you know, something like Interface is interesting.
Yeah.
Because they're based on a complete circular economy model in terms of their product. They provide a service, you could argue, but it with low environmental impacts. But there's never a zero impact, I think, obviously, with any company.
Well, it's funny, tripping a little bit in here that,
yes.
For the information, actually, the social impact or social investment in here is a bad name. I mean, I agree with that, because it's brought up from England. In America, we just talk about the impact investments. I mean, and I agree with them, when people talk about social in here, they think about NGO. Right? So I think, oh, this is not the real case that we've been trying to, as the kind of like impact investments and all those things in here. I think the fundamental is the impact, right? That's the whole thing in here. Loyalty is great, you know, and in certain ways, great, it's all different. I think the whole things we look into, I mean, I think there's a study talking about, you know, I think it's done by Temasek University at one time, and who are the more successful impact enterprises, it's called social enterprise, is those who are putting the focus on their subject. I think before we talk about marketing, right, you have to think about what kind of service you're focused on, what kind of products you're focused on before we can talk about marketing. Right, that was going to the market, right? If you haven't done that part in here, then you have a problem. You know, you've been going around in here. So what I'm saying in here, before anything talk about in here, whoever's designing, starting an enterprise who wants to address things, social needs, needs to be knowing the industry very well. I mean, the biggest problem I see many people, especially students in here, oh, they see a big problems in certain long term in here, and then they jump into it without looking into the details. I mean, the success of CM Organics, for example, like Neil, is basically they live there and understand the farmers, you know, then they see the needs of the farmers and then addressing the needs of the farmers to move into rather than just you know, doing things from outside, thinking the whole thing. Another thing is that any enterprise, we all know starting enterprise in here is 99% of the of any startup enterprise fail within the first 3 years. Alright? How are you gonna hang on to this 3 years, 4 years, 5 years before you turn into Phoenix? It needs commitment, sweating, everything. It's not gonna be lighthearted. I'm taking a bit of the aeroplanes and analogies and say, okay, you can go to flame. But if it fails, it drops down, you die. You spend all your savings, you die. You know, your dream die, and it's not going to be a very nice thing to think about. I think it's, sometimes I allow me to say that I think that everything, you know, we're right, you know, again, I throw it out in here. You talk about the marketing, right, kind of thing. But maybe social enterprise start off from a grassroots level organization and then send all things and grow. They may not have this kind of experience in terms of the business, the scales, and every ego comes into play in here. That's why they're reluctant to do something differently. But having said that, I have a big problem, honestly, for scaling in the mass scale. Deutsche is a problem. There are Royal Projects a problem. Even in Bangladesh are problems of this NGO, because they're crowding out other people joining in. So it becomes over-dominated by this organization, you know, putting its perspectives. Royal Project. Big problem. They throw away a lot of food, right? Because it's funded, right? They don't get the ROI, the whole thing. And we have farmers who do not want to supply to give it to them, right? But they have all the infrastructure.
Because they don't, why don't they want to sell to?
Well, because, you know, it's all about people, you know? At the time in here, the organization is getting so big, so bureaucracies in here, down at the station level, they may not have the heart as is the Great Kings been, you know, coming through here. So things getting a bit corrupted all
so
along the way.
People aren't getting paid on time?
No, they're getting paid in here, but offer price is something, you know, obviously.
Pricing
coming here.
Yeah.
And on top of that, they cannot focus on organic. right? Because of scale. You know, in my industry of anything here, that we need the scale, we have a lot of scales in here. Royal project cannot have the scale, right, to only be organic. Then you're gonna have a problem. You can encourage the farmers to put chemical. Okay, you're moving them into economic development, but the whole thing is not sustainable. Right? Corn industry, they keep buying corn. So I think the whole thing is they move along the development stage, you know, certain times do different things. And again, back to the whole things in here, we have great organic communities in the Nantang area, small, great, selling well, you know. Why do I have to talk about as big as Royal Project? You know, they're able to sell, they make sustainable everything, social fiber connected, addressing issues within their local community. I think it's great. Small is beautiful. Mm-hmm. In a certain way. Just like the, you know, this I see it many times on the aspect when we have to have a scale up into a very successful business.
I think I kinda agree with Spencer on two things. I think marketing is really important if you want to scale. But I don't think you can entirely focus on marketing first, because especially doing something like entrepreneurship, it has to be like practical and hand-on. It's maybe linear, I mean, together with marketing, you have to develop the product, try out. But in order to success or fail, I think it's the ability to be reflexive enough. You fail down, you jump back quite fast, how resilient that of the model of the product and service that could be. And another thing is, I think in terms of scale, I agree that either what you call SE and GO or whatever, in order to do impact, getting too big would be really hard to do. So not like growing your business or company, but how you can share that and make other people like follow. It's like you don't have to like do all over like Thailand, the region, but you do something that you want to do, and answering to your mission quite well, and you share certain things, I mean, enough in order for others to replicate, and then that's for me, that's, and when I talk about scale, it's like that's the scaling for me, not like yourself, but
so you two are happy, you think there's enough scale at a small level that you're happy social entrepreneurs that are only doing things in the local level.
I think what they're saying is, like, so you develop at a small scale something that works really well, mm-hmm. a good model, and then others can replicate that model in other areas.
That's like a process of scale in itself, right? Mm-hmm. But what are you actively doing to make other people replicate that model?
We publish what we did with the process, the tool, like open data.
Right. What I would like to see is like rather than just like, because you can think about the business model as a product, right? You've innovated a business model as organic farming companies, right? Thailand is full of rice farmers that aren't doing organic farming. Right? There's a huge problem because I don't even know enough about the problem to really define it, but I assume that there's so much destruction of the land and the quality of the soil. And you've got a product which is a business model that could be replicated all over time. Is that correct? And so what can we do to actively replicate that model? What is the machine that we can set up to make sure that we're getting the attention of other farmers? We're communicating the idea to other farmers. We're getting them to test and sample the value that can be created for their own crops. Right? And then we're getting them to commit to actually implementing that business model. Unless someone is actively building that machine, it's not going to happen. Right? And the situation that we currently have is going to perpetuate. That's my perspective. And I feel like the problems that we have right now, whether it be organic rice with rice farming, the pollution in the air that's outrageous this morning, it's made my child sick, everything has just reached such a huge scale right now. But I'm personally not happy with saying a small-scale, locally innovative business model that doesn't replicate and doesn't actively scale to completely change the system. That's not enough for me anymore.
Well, that's when the technology part come in. How to replicate that, how to
So in terms of replicating this?
Yeah, or building the whole new ecosystem, I mean, like region by regions.
The question that started was like, what is a social enterprise which I think is scaling well, or demonstrates these qualities of scale that I've been trying to articulate strangely today. I feel like the business models that can collapse those two dimensions are social and commercial return. So basically the delivery of their core product is also the delivery of impact, rather than making choices between the two, right? It's all just one. So there's some business models that are like that. Creation of organic rice perhaps is like this as well. I'm not sure if when you're a rice farmer, you make a choice to increase your yield and your commercial return, or increase your impact in terms of reducing the cost of the soil. If there's a trade-off, then the two axes don't collapse, right? But there are some social enterprises or impact businesses, whatever you like to call them, where I feel like two axes are collapsed, right? Where the core delivery of your product and the making of money is intimately and inseparably linked with creating impact. So that's one thing, collapsing into two dimensions. I feel like the technology frontier, organizations that are riding new ways of technology, right, to occupy new spaces of possibility in terms of new types of business models that can be created. Because every new wave of technology throughout the whole of history has created mega businesses, right? Think about sailing in the Dutch East Indies Company. You can think about combustion engines and the big oil companies. You can think about computers and the big tech companies. You can talk about internet and the big internet companies, mobile, blah, blah, blah. Every new wave of technology that's fundamentally changed, there's been new businesses that have occupied that space and reached scale faster and harder than any other businesses ever come before them, and far greater scale and speed than all businesses around them. So social enterprises, where are the social enterprises for blockchain? Where are the social enterprises for the Internet of Things and for artificial intelligence and augmented reality? Like, I'd like to see social enterprises occupy that space. And so that's the second thing, really being at the frontier of technology. And then this thing that I've been harping on about all day is putting marketing first, in terms of like thinking about marketing as the most core fundamental part of their business model. That's three dimensions that I think the ultimate social enterprise would have. I can't think of any off the top of my head that are doing that at scale, except maybe one, where it's a friend of mine who set up a company in Myanmar. It's called Koko Tech. Anyone you heard of it? K-O-E-K-O-E Tech. Him and his cousin's a doctor, they came into Myanmar right at the beginning of the mobile telephone wave, because nobody in Myanmar back in 2012 had mobile phone coverage. And so there's this wave of technology where all of a sudden, the whole of Myanmar was coming online, had access to mobile phone devices, and they picked a specific problem to address, which was maternal health. Right? And they used this technology to set up, basically, they set up a Facebook group that was around women's health during maternity, childbirth, etc. They then developed a mobile phone app that group sort of was used to as a marketing funnel for that mobile phone app. And the mobile phone app was quite simple in terms of its content, but it was just like, how do you, you know, have a safe pregnancy, etc. How do you provide nutrition for your children? And it's taken off significantly, and a lot of mothers use it. In the same way as like pregnancy apps, I'm not sure if you guys have had children, but pregnancy app, when I had my baby a year and a half ago, it was huge. It provided so much information. So the other thing that they're doing interesting is like, the man of mine, he would never call himself a social entrepreneur. He is an entrepreneur, and the other guy is a doctor, right? And in terms of these axes, the doctor is fundamentally involved in a product, making sure that the delivery of information services to pregnant women is fantastic. They've got a whole team of people that is involved in marketing in terms of making sure that they reach pregnant women at a particular time when they're thinking about having children or having children. And then Mike is wholly focused on getting funding for the company. He just like goes around to the Ashokas and the Ackerman funds and makes that his full-time job and just like pouring money into the business so they can keep scaling the operation and reaching more people. Particularly by leveraging their marketing machine. They think about their cost of customer acquisition and they just pour money into that, basically saying to all these funds that have money, treating them like customers and building a marketing machine around getting donations. They're not treating any differently. It's a B2B marketing machine that Mike is fantastic at, and he's got all sorts of metrics about how he's performing that as well. So I think that's the example that comes to mind, mainly because I know them and I know what they're doing and I know how they're operating, but there's not that many social enterprises that I've worked with that are working at scale that I have that sort of internet with. So, yeah.
No, I think the whole thing is, again, it's your business. Right? The things that we discussed on here is that you have to look at your addressable market. Right? I mean, the example you mentioned here, that whoever started as an entrepreneur, you see there's a need on these kind of applications within the country, within the industries to address the need. And then from that point onward, that's with anything, see, you know, first started movement, that would, advantage in here that they're able to start it first, get it going and ongoing and eventually capture the market.
Mm.
I think the biggest issue with many social entrepreneurs is that they copy other people's things and put it into their whole things in here. That's going to be very difficult because you know you see someone, okay, let's say you copy and you will never get a scale as compared to the big player. And do it in here, so that how you would fight in the market.
Personally, if someone copied your business model in terms of organic rice farming and applied it at scale, even if it was like CP Group or another big corporate, I'd be totally fine with that.
I'm totally fine with it. No, I'm totally fine with it. You know, that's what we try to do is our networking here, or our business model share with everyone.
Mm.
You know, we just, again, one thing I personally believe is we're not aiming to scale because there's so many things we cannot do within the food industry. Cannot spend time on both at the farming level, farm management, down the whole chain, logistics and marketing, because we specialize on marketing and logistics and all those things in here. So we partner with one thing. So that's the SDG 17 is collaborations. And I totally agree with you, the private enterprise, if we partner, have more partnerships in here, that why do you need scale? Every unit, you know, is functioning as a network. And together, we lift the whole, the social space in a better picture. That will address the issues. Rather than fighting to be scared and monopolize bigger money in here, we are the best, we can do it better in many ways. I think that is defeated the whole purpose, beating competition.
I think every industry has a different, there's a different situation about rice than other products, so this is,
So I guess today I just like tried to share my perspective about where social enterprises might be falling over and could be improved. But yeah, when you're thinking about very specific industries, very specific business models, certain ideas might apply better than others. But yeah, in the future, I'm going to be setting up a social impact incubator and accelerator in Tamasa, but I'm not 100% sure. I want to, in that, apply some of these principles that I've been talking about in terms of like prioritizing scalability, not prioritizing the theater of social enterprise and startups, just thinking very much about impact and commercial viability. If you have any thoughts about how I can build an accelerator or an incubator like that, please let me know, and I'd love to keep in touch. Just before I left this morning, I thought, I better start a mailer of some sort so I can start sharing what I learned about this while I'm doing this research in Thailand about the social incubation space. But at the same time, I don't want to sort of fog Alex's perspective. This is his house, and I don't want to, you've got your own form that you're asking people to fill out here. So I just put that. But if you want to keep in touch with me, that's the best way to do it, I think.
Cool.
Well, maybe I have a question in this aspect in here. Then you talk about innovation, we come across many things in here. What kind of financial returns normally, you know, investor looking for? Okay, you are short enterprise. Okay, mm-hmm. I have the money. I got, you know, many US dollars. Okay, again, we are investors. So what kind of financial return normally?
In terms of investment?
Yeah, in terms of investment.
A purely commercial investor versus a social investment firm?
Whatever you're looking to evaluate a business, okay? Long as the money in here.
So imagine this is cash flow over time, right? Sorry, cash amount over time, right? I guess a stock. Every entrepreneur starts with some money, right? And they drop, they lose their setup costs, and then they go through the valley of death, and they actually get their commission. Investors at a seed stage will come in here. If you've got an idea, you've got a product, awesome. Let's open the doors to your business, come in here. Because they're taking a huge risk, because it could do this, it could do this, right? But the average fund needs one of these in mind, right? This would be like a 10 times return, a 5 times return, 3 times return, and a 0 times return. An investment fund of like $100 million, take 2% fee over a 10-year life of the fund, which would mean around about $20 million. So $80 million left to invest, right? They don't know which one's going to be. Let's say they're investing in 9 companies. In 9, 3 will be like this, 2 will be like this, 2 will be like this. And this is like on average how an investment fund would work, right? So they're looking for as many of these as they can, right? And this I feel like is the same for an impact investment fund or a commercial investment fund, right? When someone gives their money to an impact investment fund, they are hoping to have some sort of social return. Just not being in this space, right?
Sure.
But nobody's measuring social impact as much as they're measuring financial impact, right? No investment fund I've met, at least, really is going to be able to compare the different outcomes also on an impact investment dimension. All they do is treat impact as like a hurdle requirement. Do you have a theory of change? Okay, so you're reducing poverty by the same thing. Therefore, we can say that you're not in here, and therefore we just treat you like a commercial thing and try to get a commercial return. Because
what about time frame?
Time frame.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the average fund, you know, they're looking for a 5-year exit.
Mm-hmm.
If it's, you know, in most commercial
funds.
Look, maybe because of the way that they're marketing and the sort of investors they get to invest into their fund.
Mm-hmm.
There's less expectations in terms of commercial return.
Right.
But basically, over 10 years, they want to have a threefold return.
Threefold.
That's the average fund. Whereas if you compare it to like Sequoia Capital and
right.
Silicon Valley, you know, they're a ridiculous return because they would really be internet boom.
Mm-hmm.
If you're talking about Southeast Asia backed investment fund like Intertor or LBT or something, I'm not sure what their expectations are, but they probably have less sort of an expectation of such a high return. And they would go to the people that, like high net worth individuals or corporations that might invest in the fund, they say, look, we will return your money and we'll deliver an impact. And maybe that's a sufficient sales pitch.
Right.
But at the end of the day, if someone else comes in, we're going to create a great impact. And they'll sort of describe all sorts of fuzzy stuff in terms of their impact dimension. But we're going to create a 2x return in 10 years. Then they're going to outcompete the guys who say, well, it's a 1x return. And so I feel like eventually it's always going to come down to a commercial return argument, even if they say they're an impact investment. However, if you're talking about like a donor, they're accepting that it's a 0 return, and they're going to be trying to measure different ways.
Because many of the development work is a long-term thing. Okay, I mean, you talk about, let's say, like the erratic properties, you know, it takes at least 20 years, 10 years for the economic development. I mean, to get it within 10 years, a tenfold solve the problem, I think it's quite difficult.
But that's that's like the market standard, really.
Yeah.
If you're an investor, that's where. I mean, if you're an impact investor, as I said, maybe it's less, maybe they're more patient, maybe they drag things out into 10 years instead of a 5-year return. But I mean, I nearly sold equity of my first social venture, and yeah, as soon as I said, yeah, we're going to be helping entrepreneurs to build businesses, it's like, cool, now what's your commercial return? Yeah. And then we're basically doing net present value calculation of our future expected returns. And it was 100% commercial. And this is Institute Manager, which is one of the leading impact investment firms in Southeast Asia, I think. But yeah, they for the first 5 years of their presence in Myanmar, they made no investments. They didn't invest in India because I did a smaller scale prototype that didn't require investment because there's too much uncertainty in a business model. But yeah, it took them about 5 years to find one investment.
Yeah.
And eventually with like an agriculture play or something like that. But someone to that is not a negative social impact side of things, but would still create a positive impact return. It's kind of hard to find, particularly their expectations of speed and scale.
Yeah. And have you looked at decentralized structures to scale? Most of what I'm hearing is basically centralized approaches, peer-based approaches, decentralized-based approaches.
I guess I'm not familiar with the concept.
Well, Bitcoin's an example of that. It grows by adoption.
Okay.
It doesn't grow by market.
Yeah, okay. I mean, you could talk about Bitcoin. You can think about a lot of products that have sort of taken off without marketing effort, and they're usually at the technology frontier, where it's a word of mouth sort of thing. But I haven't invested in Bitcoin. I don't know about it, but
it's still at very early stages. It's pre-adoption. But it follows traditional S-curve of adoption.
But each, apart
just like, just like Uber, just like Airbnb, they're all examples. But
are you talking about this sort of value benefit of that?
Well, it's called an S-curve, an adoption curve.
Okay.
Printing press, everything, technology follows S adoption.
On a practical level, what would that mean for an entrepreneur if they're doing a decentralized?
Well, thing? You mentioned you're talking big corporations and things. They're all centrally organized. They're centrally managed.
Yeah.
Basically, they operate with centralized systems.
Yeah.
Not distributed, decentralized systems, which are more peer-based, based on the people.
Right.
You leverage the people, you leverage the relationships.
Mm-hmm.
You know, marketing is very manipulative. You're manipulating someone's thinking.
Yeah.
With marketing, traditional, that's what marketing is about.
Mm-hmm.
Peer-based adoption is very different. There's less manipulation.
So,
and it has the ability to scale exponentially. Centralized approaches are not exponential. They don't have exponential capability in terms of scaling.
I disagree with the last point. I feel like you're talking about like a different ownership structure from the traditional venture.
Yes.
Like it's something that's distributed, it's not owned or administrated by one individual.
Yeah, like the internet, for example, is a distributed, decentralized structure.
Whereas when you go, at least from my perspective in terms of coaching entrepreneurs, it's assumed that it's 100% owned by them. And then it's their venture that you're helping them to grow. In terms of building a decentralized product or business model, then no, I haven't really considered that at all. But yeah, it sounds like it's something that happens at the sort of technological frontiers that I'm not really necessarily dealing with here. Like Bitcoin, sure, it's a distributed ledger system, which is an interesting product, but even then, like, I met a guy the other day who was working in Bitcoin and he just had a product who was trying to do like an initial coin offering, and it was a marketing challenge, right, to get their heads above all the other types of cryptocurrencies that were also decentralized. It was still a marketing problem that individual guy was trying to apply to his individual business model, which he individually owned. In terms of a decentralized company that isn't owned by anyone, that isn't delivered or administrated by anyone, I just don't think in those terms, I guess.
And It's just stuff as a bottom stuff. So, you know, that's it. One of the smart contracts, for example, like EOS, I think DApps. So it's basically distributed apps.
One thing that I think is thinking about systems lately is like movements, and they're also kind of decentralized. You take like Greta Thunberg and protests about climate change. She doesn't own it, she doesn't have control over it, yet it's something which people are identifying. It's got brand sort of identity. It's got its own little sort of like, I'm not even sure if it has a logo, but people are saying, like, you know, okay, doing this stuff.
Basically, you're putting structure out there, you're putting governance out there.
But I think it's interesting.
And everyone can participate within that structure.
It's really just putting an idea out there. People start to participate in the idea. But there is no marketing funnel yet. It's just a word of mouth thing. But how do you create a movement like that? How do you start applying that movement and that energy, that intention to actually solving a specific social problem? So far, it's just happening with protests. But maybe there are other sort of ways that you can direct that energy into like more sort of like a traditional business model, which is governed and administrated and trying to solve a specific problem.
Sure. Maybe another example, some of the delivery services you're seeing around Bangkok, Get, Go, there's like six or seven that are basically, they're profit-making, but there's no employees involved. It's very peer-based.
Okay.
People are freelancers and they're on a freelance basis. Similar to like Uber.
So you're talking differently, like a decentralized platform like that, but even those... I think they're kind of owned. You can also put impact-oriented products on those services. I'd love to be able to like order food on Grab and ask for like, you know, just deliver the food and not pack it in. Why don't they do that? I think this is probably over time now, right? Any other questions?
Is there any burning short question?
Short
question. Right?
Well, I don't know. It depends. you said regarding the designing the engine to bring it down to one function, strip away all else.
Yeah.
I have to totally disagree with you.
Okay.
And the one that I mentioned already regarding my Uber catch up flood prevention system, right? The basic design is to prevent flooding, but it can do. Develop infrastructure, can generate electricity, enhance production from rice farmer or any farmer whatsoever. It can introduce technology and jobs, employment. It can develop the country.
But you're still just talking about a product, which you're not scaling.
Well, it's going to cover the entire river system of Thailand. That's a fairly, and it can be transported.
But what has to happen in order for that?
It can go to any world, any river system in the world to prevent flooding.
Then let's talk about the marketing models to make sure that...
Well, that's what I was going to ask you after this, whether I didn't want to make it there. But in terms, I'm bringing it up to the only you're saying is only bring it down to one point. Well, I'm just showing you my design here. The main point is flood prevention, but it's got a multiple set of strings attached to it as well, which are the benefit of that first point.
Yeah, I mean, if you're an entrepreneur in an acceleration program that I'm running, I basically say, what is the bare minimum product in your concept?
I've got that.
And what is, who is a customer who is actually going to pay for it? And what is your approach to getting their attention and developing an attitude?
Well, I can give you all that later on. I don't want to make it this.
But even then, like, from my thesis, which I was sort of like roughly and convolutedly putting out today, it's still you're in the wrong mindset. You're obviously very passionate about your product, but I feel like someone who could out-compete you is someone that thinks about, okay, flooding in an e-com person is a problem that I'd like to be involved in. We got Michael from the
forum. No, you wouldn't like
that. Right? And then start, like, I got this mailer, like, start a mailer around that. Start driving people's attention to that problem. Start developing, convening a community and start creating content around it And then all of a sudden people are starting to flow. You're getting air over your wings. And then all of a sudden you can start thinking about, well, now that I've got all these customers with this problem, I'm talking to them. Once you've spoken to, I feel like every entrepreneur that comes from a program, I say, talk to 200 of your potential customers. And then design your product.
Can you imagine when the people I've spoken to over the last 8 years, 200, put another zero on it, perhaps, and you're getting closer to the number. And at high level, at high academic level, at high political level, at high government level, in various countries around the region.
How many of those potential customers?
They're all potential customers.
When I say customers, someone that would actually pay you money to implement your product.
I'm not wanting any money. I'm saving the world. I'm retired. I'm donating this to the save the world concept.
Maybe there's a decentralized business model that I'm not thinking about. But if you want this to be, you're creating infrastructure.
Huge infrastructure.
So you're going to be using construction companies that demand money for their time.
Yes.
And so therefore there's a need for money come into your business model.
Most definitely is. So I'm approaching it on a government level. It can only be done on a government level with political will, because you're interfering with the structure of a country.
Right. Well, you could go
on. No, I'm just saying, I think you guys should continue your conversation. Well,
that's what I was going to do. That's what I said at the start. But the basic point was, I disagree with that. We have done to one thing, because that one thing automatically unfolds a myriad of other benefits too, which are...
There's all sorts of complexity that comes with business models, every single business model.
But they all drive the reason to do this, create this infrastructure.
Oh, any of this? Anyone knows the 80-20 rule, right? Yeah. Okay. These are all the effort you can do. Whether that's talking to government, creating products, everything, building your marketing machine, whatever you could do to try to push your business forward. And this is the total impact, right? When I say impact, I mean social impact in terms of like the outcomes that you're trying to achieve as a business. Right? If we line up everything from the most impact from this one activity to the least impact, right? There's this Pareto rule, right? Where it's called the 80-20 rule, because 20% of all the total things that you could be doing in terms of your efforts, in terms of your impact, will lead to 80% of your results. Right? And so you're talking about complexity. Like, there's all this stuff that you could be doing. There's all these sort of spillover effects. What's the one thing that you get up tomorrow morning and actually start doing to create the most impact? Because there's also the 90-50 rule, where so if you can do one thing that creates 50% of the outcome, instead of trying to do everything, recognizing all the complexity and all the little fires you have to put out, just do that one thing 10 times, because this is 10% of the effort, this is 20% of the effort, and then repeat, call it your marketing funnel. Maybe it's your marketing funnel, I think it should be your marketing. Invariably, this is sales.
Thank you very much. That's what I do, though. I do my river catch prevention system. That's the thing. And then I throw in all the add-ons to show them why that's what you need to do. So it's not a simple enterprise. This is
a
larger thing.
I think Alex is giving me eyes now. But yeah, guys. If you want my email address as well, if you want to continue chat, there's how to get going today. It's
tu.ac.th.
It's new, so.
Is this like, who am I at the moment in your life?
Remember?
No,
I just got an email address a week or two ago. So. But yeah, if you guys are interested in this idea, I don't know where it's going yet, but I do have an intention of building an incubator and accelerator. But I'm interested in doing more in social impact oriented businesses in Thailand, because I've been here for a few years and I'm interested in that aspect.
All right, well, thank you very much, Pete, for your interesting talk. I think he brought up a lot of tools that we could start to use in thinking about our various ventures a little more practically, and some important ideas that maybe we can coax him to come back here again to do a follow-up on this. But we'd just like to give him a small token of our appreciation and you know, the standard photograph.